Good evening, everyone. Hello. Welcome. My name is Fiona Rogers. I am the V&A Parasol Foundation Curator of Women in Photography. I'm also the LX Parry Photo Curator this year. And my selection, my pathway this year looks at the concept of the lived experience and a kind of alternative way of looking. We've just finished a earlier talks program with some of the exhibited artists. Also felt really, really important to host a keynote by a fantastic individual. I'm just going to introduce these two wonderful people. So Dr. Mark Seeley, OBE, is the executive director at Autograph. He's also the professor of photography, rights, and representation at the University of Arts London. Seeley's interested in the relationship between art, photography, social change, identity politics, race, and human rights. He's written extensively for journals, artistic publications, and curated numerous exhibitions, commissioned photographers internationally, and also worked with filmmakers. He has a PhD from Durham University and is the advisor to leading institutions, including Tate, Paul Mellon Center for British Art, ICP in New York, and the World Press Photo. His recent publications include Photography, Race, Rights, and Representation in 2022 and Decolonizing the Camera in 2019. Going to be chairing a talk today with the wonderful Dr. Deb Willis. Woo! About time, an absolute honor to have Deb with us. Deb probably needs no introduction, actually, but for the sake of filming. Deb is a university professor and chair of the Department of Photography and Imaging at Tisch School of the Arts in New York City. She has affiliated appointments with various international institutions where she teaches courses on photography, identity, cultural histories of visualizing the black body, women, and gender. She's the director of NYU's Center for Black British... Black visual culture, and her research initiatives include photographic histories of race, slavery and emancipation, contemporary women photographers, and beauty. She's the author of numerous books, including The Black Civil War Soldier, A Visual History of Conflict and Citizenship, and has curated numerous exhibitions, such as Free As They Want to Be at Photo Focus. She's the recipient of many accolades, too many to mention here, but including a MacArthur Fellow. And I'm absolutely delighted to say that she's also joining the selection committee for this year's V&A Parasol Foundation Women in Photography Prize. So we are absolutely honored. And fantastic to have Deb and Mark with us. So over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Can I just say it's always, acoustically, this is really quite a challenging environment. So I'll try and artificially speak loud if that's possible. I just formally like to thank everybody at Parry Photo for the opportunity to be here today. I'd also like to really, just before Deborah starts, is just to kind of do a little bit of an outline about why I'm sitting on this stage today. Because basically back in about 1991, when I first started my role at Autograph, Deborah Willis was kind of one of the few people that was out there, one of the few people that was kind of thinking kind of strategically about what it means around photography and black visual culture. I still well up, I think about those times. It was a kind of highly emotive space of thinking, really, when we were trying to, you know, think about what we build as a future space of representational politics. Deb was working at the Schomburg Center in New York, early historian, trying to add value to those memories and places and do what I would call real curatorial care work. And I'm very old-fashioned when I think about those curatorial care things, those images, many of which have been abandoned by society, photographers' works, not catalogued, not recorded, not mentioned in history. It's not that long ago that Deborah Willis and I were having a conversation about Van der Zee's work where, you know, editorial spaces were trying to lock the work into a very particular discourse, where really, when we have someone like James Van Der Zee, we have a seminal photographic figure in history. I kind of walk in the shadow of a lot of the thinking that Deborah has done. I've put a little bit of light in some of the corners sometimes, I'd like to think, because that's part of the dialogic, Black Atlantic kind of conversation we have. The conversations that we've had with, in terms of autograph, with many, particularly African and African-American and South Asian and Caribbean artists, have meant that there's a kind of loose community of other histories which have been formulated, if you like, despite lack of infrastructure and, if you like, institution. What I've learned from Deborah is thinking about what institution means, both by being in them and also building them, by thinking about building narratives and sharing those, what those narratives mean. And then also the important work is about joining the dots, not necessarily across some of the spaces that we might think are kind of familiar, but joining the dots across unfamiliar spaces, unfamiliar institutions, and also at many times asking those difficult questions about race, about rights, about history, about thinking, and also about those ideas about what beauty means as well. And I think one of the things that I've learned from Deborah is the idea of like sharing is just really important. And as a scholar and as an artist, I think that form of generosity is very contagious when you sit in the company of Deborah. That sense that it's something that we can do. I know that Hank, as your son, has benefited hugely from that space. Watching him grow as an artist as well is something that we've both kind of like, you know, smiled and winked about. So I think today, really, when we were speaking to Fiona about this idea of a focus on the contributions that women have made in photography, it would be an absolute shambles not to give Deborah this kind of keynote moment, just to share a little bit of the journey around her own practice and her own thinking. And I thank you all tonight for joining us in this conversation. So Deborah, over to you. But what I will do in the next 10, after Deborah spoke, I'll have a few questions. And then hopefully we'll, in the spirit of sharing this knowledge that she has, we'll then open it up to the audience for a short while, and then hopefully build on the dialogues after that. Deborah, thank you.
Thank you, Mark and Fiona. You know, the idea of being here, I remembered attending the first Paris photo, and it excited me, and I try to attend every year. And having the opportunity when Mark called me and Fiona and everyone wrote to say, consider this, and I had to consider it with a yes. So I want to say thank you. But I also want to acknowledge Carla Williams, who's in the audience. Yeah. She just won the first book prize with Aperture, with a big check. Take it to the bank. But to know this history and to look around the room, and I see, you know, names and faces, and I'm looking at you, Brian, and, you know, Lori, everyone here, Maholi and Joy, all of you have been a part of my life. You know, Marilyn Nance and her children were at my house when they were 2 and 3, when we were researching and creating books about Black photographers. So this talk is mainly focused on, and then Mingus was a baby when I visited him and photographed. So this is family. And this is why photography is important to me. It's not only about the scholarship, not only about the missing gaps or the lost stories, really about telling the stories of who we are and how we picture ourselves. And I tend to go on too long with a lot of slides, but I can make this happen in 20 minutes. No, so, oh, you have too many slides, but I can make it happen. So I want to just start off with what the power of the gaze. These are women and non-binary women, people who are part of this exhibition. And Case, and there's my husband, often really cool. And to think about, how do we tell our stories? What do we think about? And when I met Mark and Roshini and wrote to me and Sunil and Joy, way back in the turn of the last 10 years, when Prince said, let's party like it's 1999,
We spent the 90s partying and researching our stories. And to start off with Roshani's work, really important to think about how important this camera has been for us in the last 15 years, where we have, as we live, as we migrate around the world, we think about the migrating Black bodies. We think about the stories that we leave home in the Caribbean or in Africa or in Europe, but in North Philly as well. But we're sending stories about ourselves as women and our stories about our joy, our pain, and the fun stories. And so here is an experience that we share. And Angel Samba is also looking at women and masking and what stories are told through this experience. I always start my talks with Carrie Mae Weems, who is a central figure to me and to many of us, mainly because she's looking at this historical reference about the historical reference of the gaze of Black women and Black people in general. And as she looks into the camera, she says, I looked and looked to see what so terrified you to make such images of ourselves, dehumanizing Black people. And Carrie is a way of looking at fashion, using the quilt as a storytelling moment where women in the South and women in the North, women in the Caribbean created their own clothes and fashion, refashioning themselves. Carrie also created this safety curtain in Vienna at the Opera House. To think about, and the invitation happens with major artists around the world, they're invited to create a safety curtain for the Opera House. Carrie decided to use Mary J. Blige to focus on this beautiful Black woman, the singer, the stage. But to think about when the curtain goes down, this is an Opera House where she has an opportunity to look, the people in the audience have an opportunity to look at a Black woman, but also look at the image of Africa. You know, think about Swan Lake and using that swan, thinking about the flowers that she places, and then the whole aspect of hip hop and dress and fashion. So here we begin to think about how Carrie is looking at this broader sense of the gaze. And then also the experience of Maud Salter, who I met during this 80s, 90s period in London, and how she is looking at historical images of women, storytelling, thinking about Baudelaire and his lover, but also she creates this piece called Calliope. And here she's holding the daguerreotype case. She is remodeling the beauty of this woman that's reimagined through Baudelaire's writings, but also through Maud's work. With Adama Delphine Fuundo, as we think about deconstructing she, how do we think about she during the 70s with the Afro hair, the desire of hip hop with this experience of long hair and blonde and these mini stories, but then also, where do we deconstruct these moments? We deconstruct it in the beauty shop. So this is where I grew up, in the beauty shop in North Philadelphia. This is an image that I made of Carrie Mae Weems as she is reconstructing the image of Zora Neale Hurston. So my life is about text and image, but also these historical references. How do you look for stories and reading the stories about Zora Neale Hurston when she wrote to Carl Van Vechten, I like myself when I'm looking mean and impressive, when he sent her photographs. So when thinking about looking at the self at an exhibition, leaving the Carrie Mae Weems Guggenheim experience, and their women, young women are leaving for the first time hearing Carrie and hearing other writers and artists in the audience, and they wanted to document that moment. And what does it mean to document this moment? And here we have our wonderful Maholi here. And this is one of my moments that I love as we look into the mirror of this history, recognizing the beauty in a hotel room, thinking about the stories of the denial of this beauty of the Black female body, but also looking at this isolation that many of us experience as we travel around the world talking about our work. Here I am pregnant in the 70s with my son, Hank Willis Thomas. I was told by a professor that I was taking up a good man's space. And because I was accused of taking up a good man's space, and because of that, I didn't belong in my program. And to shame me as an artist, as a person who desired to be a photographer and to study at the Philadelphia College of Art since I was 10 years old, that this was a shutdown moment for me. But I just looked at the professor and there were 18 men in my class, 3 women. And to know that, to think about what he thought of me and had the desire to deny me of my dreams. And so I made this self-portrait in the 70s after he was corrected. All I was gonna do was have a baby when I graduate, one thing that he was right about. And so my husband and I did the self-portrait with this idea of this future. And then the idea of I made space for a good man is what I created out of that negative experience after Hank, my son, who goes into my archives all the time, and he found this contact sheet and decided I needed to work and think this through. And how do we rethink these stories? In the 80s, I was photographing in Brooklyn of women telling stories, women looking for ways for salvation, women who looking for homes, looking for love life and to survive this loving moment. So I'd often go to readers with friends and we'd have storytelling moments, and to document them was really important for me. And throughout this time, I was writing about Black photographers. I was looking for ways to fill in the gaps when I was a student, an undergraduate student, finding stories. I found, as my first book, I found about 500 images and 500 names of Black photographers from 1840 to 1940. And my son was really surprised as he says that I had photographs in my house of non-family members hanging on the wall. Who are these people? So here again, I decided to create these book projects from J.P. Ball to images from Picturing Us and different stories about it through the book that Carla and I did together on the Black female body, and then with Van Der Zee. It was important for me also to think about how women on the cover of books, what it meant to have these stories, how to think about the idea of Black Venus when we think about the image of Saji Bartman, and to think of how the bald head image of Suzanne during the time of that period of the 70s when we, Susan Taylor, when we had these posters in our houses to reaffirm our beauty. I found a Black woman photographer, Elise Forrest Harlston. She made images of women and families and children in the 20s and 30s in South Carolina. And these are just some of the images that she created. There's an exhibition in Greenville Museum, at the Greenville Museum in South Carolina, that is exploring her story and retelling it through some of her archival images. Also, another image, as we think about Florence Collins. and here she is, Florentine Collins. And here she's self-portrait, and then also photographing and documenting the women in her community and making these wonderful images about living in New Orleans and transforming family images. How do we transform family images, and how do we rethink these stories? And here I wanted to just share, as with the invitation, the idea of all of these women who were making images during this time, Louise Martin, and documenting Dr. King's funeral, but also looking for the women. When we look at some of these images, we rarely see the women's stories in these images. They're images. Doris Derby, who is documenting the first Congress of African Peoples Conference. She's also photographing the young girls. And girl culture is really important for me and for many of us during this time. Black girls couldn't go into stores in the South to buy clothing, that their mothers and aunts and grandmothers had to look at the clothes and decide and make clothing and dresses for these young girls to attend segregated schools. And then dress up. My favorite image by Doris Derby, where women, young girls are looking at their mothers and thinking about how they protested wearing their pearls, their hats, and their high heel shoes. And then this kind of remaking of this image and just loving these stories, what it means when you're protesting in the South for segregated signs where you can't eat, can't drink, can't eat ice cream. But here's this relaxed moment where these 3 girls are eating ice cream as they sit through a moment after Sunday school. So these are moments that shared for me that create stories about how to look at history. This is Ming Smith in the 70s in Paris, living in Paris, and also looking at Josephine Baker as an inspiration. And Corrine Simpson, who's making self-portraits, looking at herself in the camera, with the camera, to carry at the kitchen table. To Zalika Azim, who's looking at her aunt's house and after the passing of her aunt, and how they're using the cloth as a way to sit and console in a family home. Kennedy Carter, who's making a self-portrait of herself during COVID, and her father is cutting and shaving her hair, what it meant for her with comfort of looking at young girls and the idea of domestic help with them, helping to hang clothing on the line, and the joy that she feels when someone comes home and has comfort, and the joy that they share in love. And Delphine is also looking at the history of violence in our country, but she's looking with hair plaited as a young girl and looking at the deaths of Black men and looking at the history of Marcus Garvey and his newspapers. And how do we read the Declaration of Rights for Negroes during this time, but also to think about the declarations. To Genevieve Garnard, my names, I got it right because I'm counting down the clock. And then she's looking at the South. Da-da-da! Okay. So Genevieve is dressing and redressing and thinking about women in the home and as the mistress, but also as, you know, crossing the cultures of the experience, and how her stories are told through this experience, through the experience of freedom. And many of us growing up in our communities had Dr. King and John F. Kennedy portraits in our homes. And here she's rethinking the story with the flag and using these moments to share. And Layla Stevens, using her home to celebrate women in the family, in her community, and within the lesbian community as well, as she thinks about how we celebrate in our homes with photographic images. To Dina Lawson and the self-portrait, I think it's really important that we look at these women who are asking questions about the image with the camera. Yelene Rodriguez is asking the question, how do we give birth to generations of revolutionary women? And here she's creating the Orisha for that experience. Nadia Huggins, disappearing people, looking at the history as from the Caribbean and the loss of life and so many people through the Middle Passage. And the many stories that are told through her experience. And then with Renee Cox, who's looking at Miss Thang, you know, who has living in the suburbs, enjoying life, having a cigarette in a moment in her pool. And, you know, just imagine what that means. And, you know, I had a student who did a paper entitled 40 Acres in a Pool, you know, to think about what happens with life when decisions are made. And Dina traveled in Africa and around the country, just documenting women's stories. And here we celebrate a birth through fashion. We celebrate prom with Scheherazade Tillett. A prom day, and what it means for a prom for a young girl who's 16, 17, going to the prom, and how the family, grandmother and mother, celebrating these moments. And then the people in the community creating a kind of a chair, a moment, a throne for her and her dress. So beauty was central in looking at how to retell this story. And then the whole community in the beauty shop making this moment special for her. And this is what these stories were, and looking at these images were important for me over time, to think about Paulette BC Colors and the loss of a grandmother, and when we have to celebrate their life, but also take things out of the home. What happens then, photographing her bed, you know, her dresser, the dresser that she spent a lot of time with, combing hair, and what the remnants of those moments. LaToya Ruby Fraser, same stories of looking at grandmother, mother in the home. And these stories are central next to the bed, and how family photographs are used as incentive to move forward. As Jeannie Mutusime Ash in Dafuski Island, the same experience of Emily's kitchen, sharing these jars in the moment of history. To Mickey Farrell, you know, like going to the beauty shop and then this whole kind of love moment that's playful and joyful. And this is a photograph that I made of my mom, who had a beauty shop for over 50 years, and her friends who were part of this beauty shop moment. But what I loved about growing up in Philadelphia was listening to women's stories and the rules we had to live by with beauty shop women here. Limit your calls to 3 minutes. You know, you can't run around. The children couldn't run around. They gave us Ebony and Jet magazine to read. You know, they gave us the whole history of the Black diaspora through the Black color wheel from tan and hue through Ebony magazines. And then here's another image that I made when I started thinking about my mother, who was in her 80s and her friends were in their 90s. They still working, still caring for women, and women who were in their 90s who needed to be cared for, and how that experience just really transformed my life. And so here's a young woman in the back and a woman in the front who's at the shampoo. Cheryl Miller has also experienced the same thing of burning hair in the kitchen. To Carla Williams and her self-portrait, you know, this moment of what it means to be Venus, to use the camera as a way to document her own body and her own life. Daisha Harris is also looking at the history, and she's in the exhibition Free As They Want to Be. As we think about the middle passage for the enslaved people, but then also the experience of people who were leaving the South through the Underground Railroad. And here she creates these images of running to Canada, to the North, past New York, in other ways to find freedom, how to find freedom through hair. You know, there are these in bold moments in the 70s, 60s, when people wore Afro picks in their hair or used the Afro pick as a sense of identity. And Lauren Kelly is using it in a entitled Pickin'. And then we see Zanelli Moholy using the same kind of experience of these sense of flags and the sense of movement through this history of style, but also of empowerment and also of the crown. And how we see Letitia is we think about how hair is embodied through different ways of telling stories, these intricate moments of people plaiting their hair, creating historical references to homeland, to using Micheline Thomas is using Courbet's images of the sleeper and of the sleepers, but then also using as a reference, using a 20 by 24 Polaroid camera, using African cloth to celebrate that history. And these are moments that I felt that were important to how do we look at this history of Thomas Akins, who Carla and I found this image of this young woman, young girl, probably 7 to 10 years old. Her mother was Akins' maid. And we think about this, we thought about that experience. It was really difficult us to look at that image when we found it in working on the book. But Mary Elizabeth Baxter, she actually took offense to this image and decided to take on Akins as a pedophile, and to make work and create a new daguerreotype and create this image to protect this young woman and how we felt about it. So she creates this story in 2021 and creating this paste image. She has a following in Philadelphia that's really looking at how young girls who were models for some of these painters that we all think are wonderful in that time period, and now today kind of thinking about how they're using the body. To Fabiola Jean-Louis, who is also looking at the history of the brutality of the Black body and creating a style of dress, but creating these stories through these moments. Sheila is re-looking at the Black body in dreaded plastic bodies through the image that we all saw this summer of Barbie, and creating the self-portrait and different styles. To Myra Green, looking at also the family photographs that you share in lockets, but also the hair that we, when we cut hair, or save a hair of someone who passed away, but ways of telling the love and And this experience about Black love is all about what I had been thinking about as we think about Joy Gregory's work. It's a girl thing. You know, we love fans, we love Barbie, we love, you know, little short dresses. And so these are moments in our Cuban heels and you know, our dresses and our underwear that celebrate through a 19th century lens of printing. Nona Faustin is also thinking about the horrific experience of the Middle Passage, but through that Middle Passage experience, going into places where auction blocks in the New York area, using the bodies that were washed up, but also the bodies who were sold. Lorna Simpson, and it's all about the details of looking at Van der Zee's photographs and the women and the images that they celebrated. I'm going to end with a project that I worked on, and this is a project about the Civil War soldier. I worked with the choreographer, Jesse Johnson, and how we talked about the stories that I found in this book, in my book on the Black Civil War soldier, but also telling a story about the 19th century through loss, but also through the song and the experience of Joan Baez. Let's see, if I push it twice, okay. And can we turn up the volume on this video? Can we turn up the volume on the video? Is there anyone back there who can turn up the volume?
To wear a hat.
Turn it up some more. Turn it up more.
Late and there it sat.
Using my own photographs, historical images.
What hats are for when living through the Civil War. When living through a Civil War. Christmas mornings and New Year's Day, they flood with dreams and they drift away. They cling to love.
So Joan Baez
covered door.
Song is the Civil War, but it was not about the American Civil War. But I felt that the lyrics, the music connected to my experience, my research moments.
Fighters came and they pitched a tent, and everyone around here went. The fix was in. We bet and swore from both sides of a civil war. We build this up and we knock it down.
Wash your women photographs, wash your women and Black soldiers.
Town. We name a sign above the door. God bless our little Civil War. God bless our little Civil War. We daunted a party on the
books and
night.
Spies who work in the homes work with the soldiers.
They sing a song out to the shore of the women go in the Civil War.
Hank Willis Thomas's work, Rise Up.
Every truth carries blame.
Connecting
every
historical references to
indignities. Shame. Progress rides with season horse. the stowaways in Civil War. The stowaways of Civil War. Progress rides with thieves and whores in the stowaways.
Photographing street baptisms in Harlem.
The stowaways.
And connecting these stories of really is important to consider. Interweaving stories about birthing and using my photographs, women in the boxing ring, and these are moments that I wanted to share. And then finally, this is an installation at the in Philadelphia of reflections on Joan Baez's Civil War using wallpaper of Civil War soldiers that my dad was a paper hanger back in the 50s, and just to connect the way that he was a interior decorator using different types of paper to place in someone's home to create a story. I felt it was really important to think about how do we create a story about these Civil War soldiers and how to share their moments in the 21st century. Some are unidentified, some are unknown. Women were teachers at the same time. And so these are moments that I felt that if creating an installation at these moments and to share and to end with, on this history that I love and such and a part of it. And I just realized I just saw just to go back through some other moments of history through, and I just saw Lola because Lola's also in the presentation, but this is Colors of Photography. Again, when I was a photography student, I was told that we needed to learn the color wheel. I knew the black color wheel from Don Johnson. So I had the color wheel and I had my niece photograph the color wheel chart. And I was told that you can't use, black people for the color wheel. I'm like, she has on green and she has red hair and she's so beautiful. I have to use this. And so my students in my class said, this is not a successful moment. So you can't use that image. And the teacher agreed, but I of course fought with that and made my own images. And so here Karen is, some 45 years later, she's still part of my color wheel. And then this was an exhibition, Reflections in Black. The Black Civil War Soldier is the book that we just shared, Free as They Want to Be. And we have images from Isaac Julian and the cover and Bisa Butler from the exhibition. And you can see how women are part of this story of these images are part of these multiple stories. And these are just projects that I worked on over the years of telling these moments from Monica in Portugal to a young artist who's working in Rochester, Tara, who's looking at Gordon Parks's American Gothic, retelling these stories. And then here we are with Lola. during the experience of COVID and just the idea of prayer, how do we celebrate and how do we think about the deaths of the people that we lost during this time period, but how Lola's character, that she can say very easier than I can, that we see these moments of protection. We see these kind of outer space and outer life moments through these subways, empty subways, and these experiences that we all had to endure during COVID. And Lola was out in the streets documenting and finding a new narrative to think about Black life during COVID. Thank you.
Well, Deborah, that's a
history.
A kind of speed dating kind of history lesson through kind of feminist history from a Black perspective, which I really appreciate. I'm still processing, really. But I actually, I'm lying because I've thought about this question for a long time. And I'm always in the game of kind of provocation, as you well know. So I think When I think about this work, I think about one kind of key theme that keeps on rising in my in the kind of unresolved question of it all. And it's this idea of justice. This idea that, you know, we're always having to kind of make the case, kind of black people, for the space simply to be visible. The idea that we are always having to make the case for those kind of key moments in history which we're part of. And the idea of how taxing that is in terms of always making the case. And I think that question, or that moment with the professor which says you're taking up a good man's space, is really the kind of profound moment of kind of agitation that sets and is catalytic in the kind of resistance moment of that of that work. And then I think after kind of 30, 40 years of doing this work, where does that end, or has it ended? And then what's been gained in that space?
Thank you. Don't you love the OBE in Mark? it's really an easy, hard question. And as Brian leaves, because Brian was a part of this history with ICP and this aspect of vernacular photography. We talked about early on of family photographs as a central way of grounding our moments. And I felt that growing up with a photographer as a father as a photographer, his cousin who had a studio, living in moments of family history, documenting their own histories and not seeing them in the classroom, that the only images that we would see of Black people were of stoop labor and laborers. And we know that's a part of our history. But I wanted the broader history. And when that professor, that male professor, said that to me, I said, you know, it's like his lack. And I was determined to create something that shared a broader history, that no one talks about Black love in the 19th century. No one talks about Black beauty in the 19th century. And it's always about strife and struggle and death. And I thought if we could open up a new narrative to think about moments of history that shared all of the ups and downs of what life is about. And as I move forward to, okay, am I doing another book on a topic that deals with, but it's always something that I felt that was I needed to do. And sometimes in the middle of the night, like we just had an exhibition called Black Rest as Power. And to think about the fact that someone said, Deb, you don't rest. How are you going to do an exhibition on Black rest? That's a conundrum. That is not you. And the fact is, and I had to agree, yes, I don't rest. But yeah, but we need to think about rest. We need to think about how do we preserve our experiences as women who are in the dark rooms. We still have dark rooms in the studio, or in the aspect of changing our old negatives to update the same narrative. And I really felt it, I still feel it's important to think about Carla, who went back into her archives from her early period of looking at images and of herself, but to think that our stories are still opening up a new narrative about Black life. And that's why I think it's really important to continue the work that I'm doing.
Has there been a change in institutional response to the work?
Some. not a big change. I think that the curators are now identifying some of the women and of all of the people that I've found in different books. I have a new book, and Marilyn Nance and her husband and her daughter is in the book. Rafia's daughter is in the book, and she's using new media, a new way of looking at these larger images, and having an idea of having an exhibition on 42nd Street. And to see these images blown up on the side of a building, but looking at her body, her face, and to think about how do we retell the portrait through new media. And we see the portrait not only in billboards advertising or selling a product, but advertising and selling a body, a person who is about art and culture and changing the world in a different way. And so I think it's happening, but not in any major way. When we look at this wonderful event here, you know, I see a number of African photographers, you know, with their, in their works here. Rarely see African Americans here. And it's really important that we need to see more and more African photographers in photo, carry photo, in photo fairs. And that's, I love going to photo fairs because I see work that has transformed my life. I include them in my classroom, all of these, all of the works, you know, and so that's inspiration for me.
So, I mean, the making process has obviously been, as an artist, a practitioner, but the making of the books has not always been easy, right? It's always been easy to sell that space, right? I mean, which is why, personally, I think ISBN numbers are really sacred. I really care for them. It's hard when you're, when you haven't seen yourself in literature or read those stories, recognized the few that you've actually been able to get out in the world, just how precious they are. But let's talk about a little. I mean, we talk about the conversations, the networks that we had, but it was difficult back in like 84, 85, 80, 87 to even think about the idea of recognizing not only kind of black women in photography, but the idea of a black photography itself, the idea that this was something to be cared for. And what's interesting when we talk, it feels as though in the narrative that it's a long time ago. It's actually not. It's like I think some people talk about Deborah Willis as if she's dead, as if something's happened, or they talk about autograph as if it's kind of like, you know, past somehow. But it's very much living memory. And it's interesting how the kind of the moment of the now gets historicized as if it was just an easy thing now to pick up. Maybe we should talk a little bit about just how difficult those early conversations were.
Yeah, it still is. Trying to get publishers interested. I'm happy to see some of the younger publishers who are like, you know, Aperture and Mac and TM. I love that. You know, just the idea of how there are a number of younger publishers are looking again. But going to the larger press, it's difficult to find editors who will kind of quote believe that it will sell.
Understand, you know, that history. Understand that the history. Space. Right. Value that.
Well, I don't think they want to understand. I really think they want the book to sell. You know? So if they can get, you know, like I think of royalty checks, I have no idea what they really mean. You know, so I can still remember when Carl and I got our first royalty check, and it was just wow. You know, and it was. So it's not like six figures, you know, it's not a lot of money. So publishers, we need to convince to that our books are stories that they should know, and the public should part of the narrative of storytelling and purchasing our ideas to place in these publications. And when you say ISBN numbers, you know, we can look through those years of how to find the stories about the individual photographers. We know that they were like the Kamonge workshop was part of 70s, 60s and 70s. And then the Black Photographers Annual, which to me was my guide along with Gordon Parks, because Gordon Parks wrote seven, you know, biographies.
Yes.
You
yes,
know, yeah. And to autobiographies, so that his story was going to be known. And he said he was going to tell it. And each time he remembered something new and added a different title, but also added a broader narrative about his experience. And he was a mentor to me and guided me with Joe Crawford, who had the Black Photographers Annual. And Joe said, you know, like, you know, just do it. Just keep doing it. And, you know, like, people will think you're going to make money, then you're not going to make it, but you're doing it not for money. You're doing it so that these stories will live on and on. Like this image here that we have here, no one can imagine what's going on in the moment. And no one can imagine that experience. And these are narratives that we need to be reminded of.
And curatorially, I mean, there's been some gains. Some institutions are prepared to have conversation, but it's still quite difficult to look across the table of the find someone who really knows what you mean.
Yeah, and it's, but you know, it's community efforts too. I think it's really great that when Opposing Beauty is a project that we started 14 years ago, and it's still traveling. And it's kind of like, oh my God, it's still traveling. And people are saying, oh, we want to keep this going. We want this show to go on, but these images need to go back to the homes, back to the collectors. But the story of these photographers and the idea of how beauty has been ignored for so long that people have a desire that they want to, the museums, their communities are saying we need to keep public programs going on. And it has a lot not only to do the physicality of beauty, but the storytelling of what it means to work in these different industries.
So you talked at the end about the idea of rest. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to imagine what that looks like.
Yeah. I know. What does rest look like? And
because we can, I'll tell you for why. Mm-hmm. In some degree, we can think about, you know, the black barbershop, the hair salon. We can think about, you know, tender moments. But I'm thinking, you know, I'm kind of forged in a Fanonian place of a deep psychology around resistance and rebellion and independence. And ultimately, I might argue, just as a provocation, that I'm forged in violence. I could argue that space. So I could easily do an exhibition called, you know, Forged in Violence. I can see what those images might look like. I can see all the rebellious moments. I can see all the fists in the air. And then I'm like thinking, could I imagine an exhibition called Rest, knowing how taxing it is to walk, that's an interesting Freudian slip, to walk in the world as a black subject with rest as your destination?
Well, with that exhibition, it was a difficult, you know, kind of agreement of selecting images. But I think of Bill Gaskins has a photograph of the Cadillac series. And the men in my community had Cadillacs growing up. And they, rest for them is washing their Cadillac, Shining their Cadillac. And so rest is not what we all think it could possibly be if feet up reading the paper, but it's that rest of the mind, rest of the soul. When we think about, you know, with the public deaths and killings of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and all of these people, that the writers and the people who were writing about Black death and how it affected them. We see the news constantly. And we needed to exhale for a moment to think about not only rest in peace during this moments of death, but how do we rest in power? You know, how do we empower ourselves in these new narratives about rest? And it's not just, you know, going to Miami to put your feet up and go to the beach, but seeing your child move forward in an educational moment, seeing your child protected, seeing your child has food on the table. I mean, that's the kind of rest that I feel that that's really important. Not just the labor of having the opportunity to have a public picnic where people could just play and not worry about a policeman or a neighbor saying they're making too much noise because gentrification says that you can't have drums in the park anymore, you know? So these are the moments that we think that we need to kind of exhale and change, think about ideas of rest. We had a public program with the exhibition. There were two Black ER doctors, women, who attended and said how important it was for us to have that exhibition, to think about Trisha Hersey's rest as resistance. And they said that Black young doctors who are interns, they're tired. They don't think about rest. They have to take care of someone who had a heart attack, and the guy wants to go back to work because he has to pay his bills and he has to take care of his family. And then the doctor is tired, and he's, you know, 20 something years old, or she's 20 something years old. And to think about how do we talk about Black rest in hospitals, because no one's caring for these young doctors or for the patients who are, just had a major heart attack, to say, no, you cannot leave the hospital. And so we all have to be reminded in this cyclical moment of how to tell the story about Black breast in different ways. That's something that hearing these young doctors talk about that, and now the nurses who are stern nurses say, oh no, that doctor is sleeping, he's lazy, you know, and that's not, we can't use lazy and rest in the same language because of popular culture. Use those words over and over in the 18th, 19th century of caricatures of Black people. So we want to think about how to change the new definitions about rest.
That's going to be a long game because of the degree of the idea that the Black body lives in this scopic regime, that it's always watched, and we always end up in the space of being hypervigilant, even if you're not being watched. There's this sense of being constantly under scrutiny. And then the moments of that, whether it's real or imagined, the kind of psychology of that experience means that on a personal level anyway, that rest is difficult to find, to imagine. And I'm thinking, how do you break that space? How do you unhinge that? I mean, I think that music and other forms can do. I think it's interesting the kind of the performative space where we can see a form of kind of personal reconciliation emerging. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. In that, where we talk about joy a lot as well, with that sense of like understanding where you are. But I think it's not for me just about rest. It's also about a critical word, which is safety.
Yes.
Right? And then that sense of safety comes all of those reassurances that you can also fall over without being ran over, that you can also drink without being poisoned, that you can also run without being shot, that you can also shout without being locked up for being crazy, that you can eat without it actually doing you harm, that it's healthy, you know? Without all of those critical moments that kind of, that engage us, that you can actually, dare I say it, even breathe.
Yes. Let's exhale with that one. Thank you. So true. We're at our time.
Good?
Yeah. All right. We're good?
All right. So we'll leave it on. So there is no answer.
There's no
answer.
I'm not going to
leave it there because I think there's more work to do. Mm-hmm. And actually, I don't think the work is just ours to do. I think it's for others to do as well. I think one of the things about these kind of critical spaces is that we get left to do the heavy lifting. And it would be nice to share the burden of some of that lifting in a way. And that's not just about offering resources, but that's just allowing other people to pick up the kind of, and not necessarily just Black people either, the kind of cultural institution. They don't owe anything. It would be just nice if you felt as though somebody else was pushing the wheelbarrow up the wheel for a bit, right? And they were helping you build a house, right? That you might just be able to live in. So this is an offer, this conversation, as always. It's a moment of generosity and sharing. And the work that Deb's done, I just want to say two very simple words. Love you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. And if you go to Damiani's book, you know, let them know that these books are worth publishing, and so you can have a chance to purchase. Thank you.